messaging throughout the impeachment process has been wildly fucking inconsistent on nearly every account except for one. Democrats, they said that the Democrats weren't happy with the 2016 election and that they were trying to overturn the case, and that's not what it is. The Democrats want to get a corrupt fucking squad out of the White House because they don't want him in there fucking things up, as usual. Other ideas have come and gone. 45 has insisted that he wasn't pressuring foreign countries to intervene. Yes, he was. And then he'd done so again publicly. He has flip-flopped on what kind of trail he wants in the Senate. White House Chief of Staff Mick Mulvaney even changed his mind on whether there was a quid pro quo in the course of the afternoon. Yet the claim of overturning has remained constant since shortly after Speaker Nancy Pelosi announced an impeachment inquiry in late September. In a reply brief over the weekend, the squatter's lawyers accused Democrats of a brazen and unlawful attempt to overturn the result of the 2016 election and of nullifying an election and subverting the will of the American people. The White House team made the same point in the Senate floor yesterday during a debate on the rules for the trial. The notion of overturning the election has persisted because it is a powerful, though not to say true, piece of messaging. The soundbite is shorthanded that is easily understood, or perhaps easily misled. Most crucially, it provides a way for 45 and his allies to evade talking about the substance of the accusations against him. As the shifting stories the White House has told made clear, that is a very difficult task, and there are a few substantive defenses of the squatter yesterday. If, however, the whole point is to subvert the will of the American people, then it short-circuits all that debate. The problem is that the argument doesn't hold up for at least four reasons. First, to label an impeachment a brazen and lawful attempt to invalidate elections is to nullify the very point of that impeachment. Although the Constitution provides the voters to elect a squatter every 4 years, it also provides for Congress to impeach him or her between elections. There's scholarly debate about whether impeaching a squatter for offenses that occurred before an election is proper, but it's illogical to suggest that he cannot be impeached for the reasons between elections because that would invalidate elections. Why else would the impeachment exist? Second, removing 45 from office, as remote a prospect as that is, wouldn't hand the White House to Democrats. It would hand the squadency to the inbreeding redneck Mike Pence, who is not only a fellow Republican, but for whom every 45 voter also voted since the inbreeding redneck Mike Pence was 45's running mate. Third, the claim of overturning the will of voters stems from 45's frequent but baseless assertion of a broad popular mandate, despite what some of his opponents contend. 45's election was illegitimate. The Electoral College and not the popular vote chooses squatters, but it remains the case that the millions more voted for Hillary than for 45, a fact that undermines his claims of a silent majority. The inconvenient fact explains why 45 has falsely claimed massive voter fraud in 2016, why he's repeatedly lied about his Electoral College margin over victory, and why he often brandishes an inaccurate map of electoral results by country, as he did at least at a White House event last week. That chimerical mandate undercuts the claim that impeachment subverts the will of the majority of Americans. When Bill Clinton was elected, was being impeached in 1998, Democrats, including Pelosi, accused Republicans of trying to overturn the voters' will. The claim was weak then too, though there is one difference between Bill Clinton's re-election in 1996 and the impeachment vote. Americans voted in the 1998 midterm election that dealt the GOP a surprising setback, narrowing the party's margin. That election served as a de facto national referendum on the impeachment. There was an election between the 2016 election and 45's impeachment too, and the Democrats won a resounding victory in the House's races in that 2018 midterm. Finally, and perhaps most simply, the impeachment is clearly about the 2020 election, not the previous one. White House counsel Pat Cipollone almost got that right yesterday, telling the Senate they're not here to steal one election, they're here to steal two elections. But this isn't about 2016. If Democrats were seeking to overturn that race, they've done a miserable job at it. The impeachment vote didn't come until the final days of the third year of 45's term, heading into a year that is likely to be especially productive thanks to the upcoming election. In other words, 45 has already probably achieved most of what he will during his term in office, fucking everything up. It's too late to overturn the 2016 election. When Democrats embarked on impeachment, they understood that it was likely the Senate that the Senate was it was that it was likely it was unlikely that the Senate would remove 45, no matter how desperately some of them believe his removal to be needed. But they knew that the impeachment might influence the 2020 race. It could hurt both 45's re-election effort and force congressional Republicans to take a stand on impeachment that might hurt them in 2020. After all, impeachment is remarkably popular, and several polls even show a majority of plurality support for removing 45. This is why Democrats dragged out votes on specific evidentiary questions yesterday, forcing Republican senators to vote on each measure. There is naturally great irony in the squatters' defense team complaining that Democrats are trying to seek political advantage through the impeachment drama. The entire imbroglio started when 45 tried to coerce the Ukrainian government into assisting his own re-election prospects, using the power of the government for his personal gain. Democrats are merely using the Constitution's provisions to their own political advantage.